please. Now may we turn to item 6 on the agenda, which is the learning disabilities paper, including an update on the new service model and framework. I'm going to invite Jane to introduce the paper. Jane.
Thank you very much, Chairman. So, as you said, this paper sets out an update on the 5 commitments that are in our business plan for this year. So I will just highlight a few of the key things that have been delivered over the last few months and certainly since our last meeting. I think one of the things I wanted to really point out about commitment one is that the work we've done on the care and treatment reviews has had, I think, a significant impact in raising awareness and in also really focusing on what's happening for people that are inpatients. So to date, we've done just over 1,800 of the reviews. And importantly, we've supported 26 regional national events that have actually meant that we've been able to access over 350 stakeholders. We've been able to do that with experts by experience, people with learning disability, families, talking through how those should be done and how they can best be carried out. We've also done a review of the involvement of our experts by experience, and I was talking to some of the people with a learning disability who've been part of those reviews, and their response has been very positive. They felt that they've been able to contribute something very meaningful and worthwhile to the reviews. They've been able to engage with people who are inpatients, and they've been able to identify some of the key things that are either stopping people from being discharged or some of the behaviours that may have affected that. So that's been incredibly positive, and we will continue to roll those out, and particularly targeting children under the age of 18, which is one of our more recent priorities. Annual health checks and extending the offer of personal budgets are in the paper, also very important factors, and I can talk about that a bit later if you want me to. Around commitment two, we have specifically worked with the Association of Director of Children's Services and the Department of Education, particularly to ensure that the care and treatment reviews we do for children under the age of 18 are very closely linked with the Education, Health and Care Plans, which are part of the Care Act. And I think those two pieces of work, plus the looking very specifically at those children that are in 52-week residential schools, is really important. We know that there is a link between a discharge from a residential school and subsequent admission into an inpatient setting. And what we're looking at as part of the review of those is to make sure that any discharge or any leaving a 52-week residential school actually means that young people can be supported to live in a community setting. So that's been a very important and very helpful piece of work that we've done. The key thing, though, that I wanted to talk about is our commitment to close inappropriate facilities and commission more appropriate community-based services. And I have talked about that on many occasions at the board. I think it's probably worth identifying. We looked at the number of NHS inpatient beds that we've had. Since the beginning of 2010-11, there's been around a 41% reduction in NHS inpatient beds, and in the last in quarter four 13-14 to quarter four 14-15, a further 12% reduction, and we are seeing a gradual and change in commissioning intentions and a reduction. However, I think most people will say that's not fast enough, and we know that that's a commitment that we've made and others have made. So the work we've done over the last few months is to create a new service model, which will be launched by Monday. We've also identified the five fast-track areas. And those fast-track areas are similar approach to the Vanguards. They started slightly later, and they are expected to give us some significant detail much sooner. We have identified some support for those. They've got financial support, they've got people support. And they are really working at a pace to look at how can we take the new service model, how can we look at how we can commission and provide additional services in a community setting, and then what will that mean for the number of beds that we think we need. You will have heard me talk here before about the variation in inpatient provision. If you look at the number of beds per 1,000 population in the South or London, it's a lot less than it is if you live in the Midlands or the North. So one of the things we want to do is to make sure that we reduce that variation and that there is a similar approach to commissioning and provision across the country. We expect by October, therefore, to have a more detailed national plan that will build on the work of the fast tracks, which are deliberately based in the areas which have got the highest number of inpatient beds. And we will use the new service model, which focuses a lot on proactive preventative care, empowerment of people with a learning disability, using personal budgets, supporting families to be cared for at home or in a place that they choose to call home, enabling them to have access to specialist multidisciplinary support in a community setting. And then when we do look at hospital inpatient stay, which will be needed for some people for some time, that is very high quality, as short as possible, and anybody that's an inpatient will have a very clear plan for discharge. The fourth area was around, we said we wanted to establish a National Learning Disability Mortality Review, and very recently we've just published that. So we've got, through the Healthcare Quality Improvement Partnership and the University of Bristol, have announced the first national programme to review premature mortality and learning disability. It's the first time it's been done in the world. It's a three-year programme, and we would expect that to provide with some very useful information and actually a real focus on how we can improve premature mortality and make sure that the access to physical health and physical health support is certainly as strong and as good as it absolutely needs to be. And then the next commitment five was particularly around data. When I took over this programme last year, one of the things that was very clear was that we didn't have good enough information to be able to give us the facts we needed to be able to monitor progress. And we've put in a lot of work and quite a lot of manual workarounds in order to be able to give us as much data and as much information as we can. We've now transferred the assuring transformation data through to the HSCIC. It's taken a little while to bed in, but what we are finding now is that we're getting monthly data, and the quality of that data is much better. And we will expect that to continue as we carry on. That means that we've got a much stronger grip on the number of admissions, the number of discharges, the number of people that are in inpatient beds, so we can monitor that on a much more tight basis, which I think has been really helpful. And then the last thing I just wanted to talk about was the stakeholder involvement. You will have heard me talk at the last meeting around the different groups that we've set up. So we have a significant stakeholder reference group, which is jointly chaired by Professor Tony Holland and Scott Watkins, so leading academic in the field and a person with a learning disability. They have been very, very strongly involved with multiple stakeholders in the development of the service model. That has been incredibly positive, and the input that they've had. We also held a Learning Disability Awareness Week recently, where we had an event in both London and Leeds. For those of you that were able to attend that, I think we'll say it was incredibly powerful. We had some actors acting out what it meant to be a carer looking after somebody that didn't have the appropriate physical health checks. We had people with a learning disability describing what their experiences were, what the impact for them on being listened to and being responded to and being given opportunities to live a normal life. And that was really good. And we've got great commitment from both people with learning disability and their families to continue to work with us through their stakeholder engagement forum. And I'm really pleased to say that having talked about it for a while, we now have in post three people working for NHS England with a learning disability, one working in our Improving Lives team and two working in our public engagement team. They are working alongside co-workers to support them, and we are about to recruit a fourth person into our Improving Lives team. And it's one of our commitments to really support people with a learning disability to get access to jobs because that help that really does have a massive impact on their health and well-being and their ability to live as normal life as possible. So I wanted you to understand, to consider the update, to see what progress we're making. The next big step will be the publication of the service model, and that will be that should be by Monday. So I'll end there, and I'm very, very happy to take any questions.
Well, thank you very much, Shane. You know the board are very keen to track progress on this and to bring it back regularly to our meeting so that we can see how we're proceeding. May I invite questions or comments on Jane's report? Victor.
I think this is a real step forward. Well done. I really do think it shows a clear intention to reshape the vision for services people with learning disabilities, all 1.5 million of them, and I think you should be congratulated. I think there's a theme for the things that I say in this meeting, which is I'm really interested in the impact of this work on the culture of NHS England and the things that we do and what the challenges are in actually making some of this real. So if we're going to employ people with learning disabilities in NHS England to do this, to help with this, and if we are engaging with people with learning disabilities in the monitoring of the service model rollout, and if we are engaging with the relatives and carers of such people, then it should impact on, it should be uncomfortable for us. So I'm interested in how we know that and how we manage it. And I guess the other bit that I'm interested in is those people with learning disabilities who actually are a long way from employment because of the nature of their learning disability, the people who are non-communicative.
Yeah.
So I'd be quite interested in what we're doing around that. You didn't specifically refer to it, and particularly those communities that are outside, that tend to be outside the framework of consultation. We think about people with learning disabilities, so ethnic minority communities, for instance. I know there's been some work around this. I think I was present at one of the events that took place with people with learning disabilities where we talked about health checks. And I think the point that was being made during that meeting was, actually, it shouldn't be an option for primary care providers or any other provider not to provide health checks. And it seemed like it was. Mm. And there was a view that, well, why are we commissioning services that don't do health checks? Why is it an option? It seemed unreasonable for us to pay for something that isn't happening, that should. So I just wonder whether you might comment on that. But I do think this is a step change, potentially.
Okay, so you're right. So I'll start with the last bit first. Annual health checks should be happening. There is no doubt about that. And again, the issue we've found is that there's quite a lot of variation. So we're looking at, so using the data that we're now able to get, actually identifying that, and also working with primary care colleagues to help understand the best way of doing them. So some of the reasons they don't happen is because the reasonable adjustments that are needed to support people to have an annual health check are quite difficult to do, and that was what was so graphically demonstrated in the performance that we saw by the company called Operating Theatre. So it's partly supporting primary care colleagues to be able to do that with the appropriate reasonable adjustments, as well as actually almost holding a mirror up in terms of the variation and the difference in take up, which I think also helps. Your point about does it feel uncomfortable is really well made. And yes, you know, I've been involved in this programme for about 15, 16 months, and it has been at times very uncomfortable, and rightly so. And I think the colleagues that I work with, and this is truly a combined, this is not just NHS England. I mean, I've spent a long time in the NHS, and this is one of the first times when I've seen a really joined up piece of work where we are alongside ADAS, we're alongside LGA, we've got CQC involved, we've got Health Education England involved, we've got patients, carers, families, providers and commissioners involved. And it really does feel like it's difficult because there's lots of different ways of working, different cultures, different, but it really does feel like the vision and the commitment is there by everybody that we speak to. And everybody is committed to breaking down those things that are difficult. And they are difficult at times. And it is not an easy... It's not an easy programme. If it was, it would have been done a lot longer ago. So I, although sometimes I do feel uncomfortable, and some of my colleagues do, we know it's the right thing, and it's the right thing to feel uncomfortable, because people are actually pushing us to say, so why haven't you done this, or why can't you do that? And just having that type of push and people working with us to do the right thing does help. But what's very good is when, and this happened a week or so ago, when we were in a big programme board with DH colleagues, was when somebody that runs one of the Value and Families forums said, I've been involved in this and I've seen the engagement and it's been really good and I've been really happy with the way this has been run by NHS England for this particular part of the programme. Still very keen that we go further faster, but and that positive feedback is also very motivating for the staff that are working hard on this.
And the severe learning disability?
So the bit about about employment again is very well made. And so what we're looking at, when people can, it's about choice. So people making a choice if they want to work and trying to find a way of enabling to do that. But for many people, it will be having access to a personal budget that allows them to do other things that are meaningful for them. And I think that's what's important. It's not saying this individual, you know, is in a wheelchair, can't communicate, can't be given an option to do something. And we've got lots of individual examples whereby giving somebody a personal health budget or a personal budget that they've had access, they can choose to do different things and to do it well and to be able to access different communication aids that will help them be able to communicate. And so it's back down to the point I've made quite a few times. There is no one blanket approach. This has got to be very personal and very personalised to individual needs and individual desires.
Good. Thank you very
much. No other comments? I mean, I think... I'm sorry, Tim, is there...
Can I just add one thing to build on that point, which is that, on the one hand, this is obviously about, you know, massively improving service for people... But this is also led. I just want to sort of reflect on a broader point, which is this: we've been working very closely, the team that's been working with Jane, on much broader kind of ways of empowering people with learning disabilities and a whole range of other fronts. And I just wanted to bring to the board's attention one. I think another big milestone here, an important breakthrough. Again, working with colleagues with learning disability and other disabilities, has been the publication of the Accessible Information Standard.
Yeah.
Which does set is a mandatory requirement on NHS organisations to take much more seriously the vitally empowering opportunity of publishing information in ways which, you know, everybody can understand, and not publishing documents which are literally unintelligible to many people who are engaging with the service. And I just wanted to pay tribute to Jane's leadership. It's not just about service improvement. It is actually much a broader agenda around actually supporting people who are people to maximise the opportunities they've got. And the Accessible Information Standard, after years of negotiation, finally published, because we are working very differently with patient groups, advocates, particularly with those with learning disability. I just wanted to reflect on that.
Thank you, Annie. That's a very, very telling point. It's the whole environment. I think what's so interesting about your paper today, Jane, is the very broad view that it takes of the need to support people with learning disabilities and across the whole sphere of what occurs within the NHS. So we look forward to a further, and I think particularly your commitment towards to October for the whole transformation plan, the bed closures, etc., I think is something that we want to follow with great interest. Okay? I think we're done.